This podcast is for informational purposes only and is not an offer or solicitation of an offer to buy or sell securities. SNN Network and Majestway Don are not licensed brokers, broker-dealers, market makers, investment bankers, investment advisors, analysts, or underwriters. We do not recommend any companies discussed. We may buy, sell, short, cover securities in any company mentioned and may profit in the event those securities rise in value if we are long and fall if we are short. We recommend you consult with a professional investment advisor, broker, or legal counsel before purchasing or selling any securities referenced in this podcast.
And Maj, you want to introduce our next investor who's giving their pitch?
Yeah. Hey, thanks, Bobby. Yeah, that would be Andrew Walker from yet another value blog. And love to hear this pitch. I'd love to have him on with the crowd soon too. We haven't had him on yet.
Oh, hell yeah. He's awesome. I had him on Planet Microcap. He's the man. So
that's enjoy, a prerequisite everybody. For being here, Andrew.
All right. Bobby, Maj, thanks so much for having me here. It's great to be here. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Andrew Walker. I'm a portfolio manager at Rangely Capital, and I run a moderately popular finance blog, yetanothervalueblog.com, as well as moderately popular podcast, Yet Another Value Podcast. My podcast is generally centered around people pitching ideas to me where I'm kind of critiquing, pushing back, learning about it. So it's a little bit different for me to be on the other side of the chair here, but I will try to do my best. The company I want to talk about today is WideOpenWest. The ticker is WOW, and I'm hoping that's what all of you think when I'm done with this pitch. Wow, that was amazing, but we'll see. I am a shareholder of WOW. WOW is a cable overbuilder. And a cable overbuilder, it's pretty simple. It is the second cable company that comes into a city, right? So most cities have a Spectrum, which is owned by Charter, or a Comcast, which Comcast plus Xfinity, whatever. Most cities have that. A cable overbuilder is going to come in and they're going to compete. They're going to build out a cable network and they're going to compete. So I live in New York City. I get my internet and cable through Spectrum, which Charter owns. But RCN over here has overbuilt New York City. So in my building, I could either get RCN cable or Charter cable. And in addition, New York's kind of unique in that Verizon Fios also overbuilt with fiber. So I actually have three options. Now, overbuilding traditionally is actually an awful business, just terrible. Everyone who has gotten into it has either left or gone bankrupt because the returns, it's just an uneconomic business. This goes back to, for years, Google Fiber was the big scary guy. They were going to roll out. They did Kansas City, a bunch of other places. They were going to take over the country. Google Fiber, the company that prints billions and billions of dollars of cash flow a year, looked at Google Fiber and said, oh my gosh, this is uneconomic. We can't keep doing this. Verizon Fios stopped. AT&T Uverse dramatically slowed. Every cable overbuilder has gone bankrupt. So it is a traditionally awful business to go into. However, with WOW, what I look at here is I look and I say, all right, these assets, ignore that it's costly and too expensive to build this. These assets are built. So let's just go look at WOW as, you know, what are the assets currently earning? Forget about what they cost to build in the past. And I think when you look at WOW today, WOW is extremely cheap. As I am talking, WOW share price is about $13.50 per share, a little bit over $1 billion in market cap, and a little bit over approaching $3.5 billion in enterprise value. This company did about $440 million EBITDA last year. I think in the next year, we should be looking at about a $500 million EBITDA run rate as they kind of penetrate some of their edge outs and everything. I'll talk about that later. But the bottom line is WOW trades at about 8x EBITDA. There are no perfect publicly traded peers for WOW. You know, there's only five publicly traded cable players. There's WOW, and then there's Cabo, Charter, Comcast, and Altice. The other four are not cable overbuilders. They're all pure play cable companies. So there's no cable overbuilder that's publicly traded. However, in the past year, there have been several deals in the cable space. The best deal to compare is Astound, which actually owns RCN, the cable overbuilder I talked about earlier. Astound traded late last year for about 13x EBITDA. And again, this is the best peer for WOW. They're not a pure play cable overbuilder, but most of their EBITDA is from an overbuilder. And actually, if you listen to WOW's calls, they will frequently let everyone know that they are very aware of the Astound transaction. They think it is a great comp for them. And in fact, they've had discussions internally about selling some of their systems at an Astound-like multiple. So Astound went for 13x EBITDA. And because WOW was so levered, if you slapped a 13x EBITDA multiple on WOW, we'd be talking about a $40 per share stock, roughly. We've also seen a couple of other cable assets trade in the past year. Again, these tend to be cable pure plays, not cable overbuilders, but Altice and Cabo both did deals that are at greater than 15 times EBITDA. If you go and you look up in Canada, Shaw Rogers, that deal was struck at a massive premium to the public share price. And even if you look at cable-like assets like Cincinnati Broadband and Alaska Communications in the past year, we've seen bidding wars where infrastructure funds are actually paying huge multiples and huge premiums to get into these assets. So my bottom line is there is demand for WOW as a strategic target. It is very cheap. And if you've slapped any type of strategic multiple on them, WOW share price would be up substantially, in part because they're cheap and in part because they're quite levered. And one of the interesting things with WOW is, the CFO and CEO have made very clear they are aware of this public to private discrepancy in multiples, and they would be willing to sell systems to unlock value. That's my big first takeaway. WOW is cheap. But WOW isn't just cheap. I think both their business and their financials are about to inflect upward. Let me start with their business. Traditionally, cable overbuilders faced a big disadvantage because traditionally cable was about providing video. And when you provide video, the cable company has to go to all the video programmers and negotiate rates. And when Comcast would go to someone like a Discovery or a CBS, they had 30 million video subs. So they could go and negotiate with the strength of 30 million video subs behind them. WOW only has 300,000 video subs. So they're negotiating with literally 1% of the video subs. WOW would have to do higher pricing to every single video provider they had, which means that Comcast, Charter, these guys had a big pricing advantage, right? They negotiated cheaper rates with the video providers. They could pass that cheaper rate to you. So when you went and compared video pricing between WOW and Comcast, Comcast was cheaper and Comcast had a huge edge there. That goes away in a cord-cutting world going forward. Going forward, we're going to be in a more and more pure-play broadband world where people subscribe to Netflix and everything else on the side. Now it's just WOW versus Comcast for broadband. Both of them have already laid that fiber into your house. There should be no cost advantage for Comcast going forward. So I think WOW is set to, their business is set to inflect upwards because of that trend. Then there's also a financial inflection. The company's cash flow is about to inflect upwards massively. And there's two reasons for that. First, they have a term loan that they priced and they fixed their LIBOR at 2.67%. Anyone who knows what LIBOR is at now, it's a lot lower than that. That hedge, that fixing will come off over the summer. And because they're so levered, that's actually a really dramatic interest expense reduction. It's going to be about $40 million per year in increased cash flow just from this interest expense reduction. Again, this is a $1 billion market cap company with massive NOLs, so they don't pay any taxes. So that $40 million will drop straight to the bottom line. And that is a huge number for a company of WOW size. The second reason that their cash flow is going to increase is because historically, they've been focused on edge outs, which is where they take their network and, it's all across New York City and they edge it out and they add a little bit more of New York City to it. Those haven't done well, again, for all the uneconomic overbuilder reasons we discussed. And the CFO and CEO are committed to reducing those. So from 2017 to 2019, they spent $250 million per year in CapEx. They did $235 million in 2020. I think they can get below $200 million within a year or two. So look, last year, EBITDA was $437 million. Operating cash flow less CapEx was $32 million. This year and next year, I think they'll start approaching $500 million in EBITDA. CapEx comes down from $250 to $200. Interest expense comes down by maybe $50 million as that LIBOR hedge comes off and as they get some natural deleveraging from paying down debt. Bottom line, OCF less CapEx was $32 million last year. I think we're easily going to be approaching $150 million within the next year or two. And so that's the overall thing. $150 million in free cash flow to equity on a $1 billion company. That is a lot of equity, a lot of free cash flow. And the last thing I'll mention is in the medium term, I think they're a seller. They have a private equity firm, Crestview, that is a semi-controlling shareholder, owns about a third of the shares. They got involved in 2015. I think they're going to want to sell in the next 2 to 3 years. If you look at their history, they've been very successful with cable assets and with premium sales. I think that's the case here. And I think in the next 2 to 3 years, again, I said an astound multiple would be $40 per share in a sale. I think the next 2 to 3 years, we're looking at a sale. And, I would be very surprised if the number didn't start with a 3, 4, or maybe if this plays out right, 5. So with that, I will toss it back to you guys. Thank you guys so much for having me.
This podcast is for informational purposes only and is not an offer or solicitation of an offer to buy or sell securities. SNN Network and Majestway Don are not licensed brokers, broker-dealers, market makers, investment bankers, investment advisors, analysts, or underwriters. We do not recommend any companies discussed. We may buy, sell, short, cover securities in any company mentioned and may profit in the event those securities rise in value if we are long and fall if we are short. We recommend you consult with a professional investment advisor, broker, or legal counsel before purchasing or selling any securities referenced in this podcast.